Have you ever seen everyone around you acting like something is true when you know it's not true? See how one little girl deals with that in this Read Aloud with Mr. Paul. Welcome to Read Aloud with Mr. Paul. I'm so glad you could be here. Be sure and subscribe so you won't miss a single story. Today, we'll be reading The Emperor's New Clothes by Hans Christian Andersen. Translated by Naomi Lewis, illustrated by Angela Barrett. Here is our title page, The Emperor's New Clothes by Hans Christian Andersen, translated by Naomi Lewis, illustrated by Angela Barrett. Many years ago, there was an emperor who loved fine clothes more than anything else in the world. Indeed, dressing up took all his time. Did he care to inspect his army? Or go to the theater? Or ride out in his carriage among the people? Not at all. Except as a chance to show off his latest splendid clothes. He had a different coat for every hour of the day. At times when you would be told of other monarchs, he is in council. This emperor, if you asked, would be in his dressing room. Life was cheerful anyway in the city. Strangers were always arriving, and one day a pair of shady characters turned up. Well, that's what they were, but they called themselves weavers. What's more, they declared that the cloth they wove was not only of marvelous beauty, but had magical properties. Whether on the loom or made into clothes, it was invisible to anyone who was unfit for his job or particularly stupid.
Excellent, thought the emperor. Here's a real chance to find out which of my people aren't fit for the posts they hold, and I can sort out the wise from the fools. Yes, that stuff must be woven and made into clothes at once.
And he gave the imposters a large sum of money so that they could start. Straight away, the rascally pair set up their looms and behaved as if they were working hard. But actually, there was nothing on the looms at all. Soon the men were demanding the finest silk and golden thread. These they crammed into their own pockets and just went on moving their arms as if they were weaving far into the night. After a time, the emperor thought,
"I really would like to know how they are getting on."
But when he remembered that the cloth could not be seen by anyone who was stupid or unfit for his work, he felt rather awkward about going himself. Of course, he had no doubt about his own abilities. Still, it might be a good idea to send someone else. After all, everyone in the city had heard by now about the special powers of the cloth. Everyone was longing to find out how stupid or incompetent his neighbors were.
"I know what I'll do," thought the emperor. "I'll send my honest old chief minister. He's the right man, as sensible as can be, and no one can complain about his work. Yes, that's the answer."
So the good old minister went along to the room where the false weavers were making a busy show of working at the looms.
"Heaven help us," thought the old man. "I can't see any cloth."
However wide he opened his eyes, there was nothing. But he kept this to himself. Then the two cheats begged him to step closer.
"Look at the patterns, noble sir. Aren't they beautiful? And the colors, have you ever seen any like these?"
And they waved their hands at the empty looms. The poor old minister peered and stared, but he could still see nothing. The reason was simple. Nothing was there to see.
"Heavens above," he thought. "Am I really stupid after all? That has never occurred to me, and it had better not occur to anyone else. Am I really unfit to be minister? No, it would never do to say that I can't see the cloth."
"Well, don't you admire it?"
said one of the tricksters, still moving his hands.
You haven't said a word."
Oh, it's charming, quite charming, delightful,"
said the poor old man, peering through his spectacles.
The patterns, the colors, yes, I must tell the emperor that they seem to me quite remarkable."
"That's very encouraging," said the tricksters, and they pointed out more and more details of the cloth's design.
The old man listened so that he could repeat it all to the emperor, and this he did. Soon, the rogues were demanding a further supply of money, silk, and golden thread. They had to have it, they declared, to finish the cloth. But again, whatever they were given was promptly stuffed into their own deep pockets. Of course, not a stitch of cloth appeared, though the cheats went on busily moving their hands at the empty looms. Presently, the emperor decided to send another honest official to see how the weaving was going.
"Ask how soon the stuff will be ready," the worthy man was told.
But the same thing happened to him as to the minister. He looked and looked, but since there was nothing to see but empty looms, nothing was all he saw.
"Isn't it lovely?" said one of the rascals,
and they lifted up the imaginary cloth and held it before the visitor.
"See the designs, the colors!"
And they pointed out the beauties that did not exist.
"I don't believe I'm stupid," thought the official, "but maybe I'm not good enough at my work. Well, that has never been questioned before, and it had better not be questioned now."
So he made admiring noises about the cloth he could not see.
"Yes, yes, very handsome, splendid colors, superb design."
And he reported to the emperor that the weaving was magnificent. The news of the wonderful fabric soon ran through the city. At last, the emperor made up his mind to look at it for himself. So, with the two men who had already been, and a carefully chosen group of court attendants, he went to the weaving room. There were the two cheats, acting about in front of the empty looms as busily as ever. The two who had been before were the first to speak.
"What splendid cloth!" said the old minister.
And the other official murmured praise about the pattern and the colors. As they spoke, they pointed to the empty looms. They were sure that everyone else could see the lengths of fabric.
"This is terrible," thought the emperor. "I can't see a thing on the looms. Am I stupid? Am I unfit to be emperor? What a frightful notion. I mustn't let myself think it, nor must anyone else."
He then said aloud,
"Such charming material, charming! It has our highest approval."
And he nodded in a satisfied way toward the empty looms. No one must guess that he saw nothing there at all. The courtiers stared hard too, but not one of them saw a single thread of cloth. No wonder each of them secretly felt alarm. But aloud, they echoed the emperor's words.
"Charming, charming!"
They even advised the emperor to use the material for a new set of robes to wear in the great procession that would soon be taking place.
"It is so magnificent, so unusual."
Every courtier felt obliged to murmur something of the kind, and the emperor gave each of the swindlers an honorable decoration and the title of Imperial Court Official of the Loom. On the eve of the great procession, the cheats were still at work on their imaginary task, the making of the clothes. All through the night, they busied themselves by the light of at least 16 candles. The outfit had to be finished in time. To the waiting courtiers, the weavers seemed to be taking heavy folds of cloth from the loom. They seemed to be cutting with big tailor scissors at something invisible. They seemed to be stitching away with needles that had no thread. At last they announced,
"The clothes are ready!"
And now the emperor made his way to the room with the most noble of his courtiers. At once, the tricksters held up their arms as if they were lifting something.
"Here is the jacket, your Imperial Highness! Here is the cloak!"
So they went on.
"Their special quality is that they are light as gossamer. You might think from the feels that you are wearing nothing at all, but that makes them differ from all the usual heavy and cumbersome robes."
"Yes, indeed," said all the courtiers.
But since there was nothing to see, nothing was all they saw. The rogues went on.
"If your Imperial Highness will graciously take off the clothes you are wearing now, we shall have the honor of putting on the new ones here. You can see the effect yourself in the great mirror."
So the emperor took off his clothes, and the impudent pair pretended to hand him the new set, one thing at a time. Finally, they made a show of fastening on his train.
the imaginary costume was complete. The emperor turned and twisted about in front of the glass.
"How elegant it looks!
What a perfect fit!"
murmured the courtiers.
"What rich material!
Such splendid colors! Have you ever seen more magnificent robes?"
No one would dare to admit that he saw nothing.
"Your Imperial Highness," said the chief master of ceremonies, "the canopy waits outside."
The canopy was to be carried over his head in the procession.
"Well," said the emperor, "I am ready. I agree with you that it is really an excellent fit."
Once again, he turned this way and that for his final look at the mirror. The courtiers, who were to carry the train, bent down as if to lift something from the floor. They were not going to let people think that they saw nothing there. So the emperor walked forth in stately procession under the splendid canopy. People in the streets or at the windows called out such things as,
"Doesn't he look magnificent?
Those new clothes, aren't they marvelous?
What elegance!"
Can you wonder? For nobody dared admit that he or she couldn't see any clothes at all. That would have meant that the person was a stupid fool or no good at his job. Indeed, not one of the emperor's gorgeous outfits had ever been so much praised. Then, in a moment's silence, a child's puzzled voice was heard.
"He's got nothing on."
"Shh," said the child's father. "These little ones do talk nonsense." But a whisper moved through the crowd.
"A child over there says that the emperor has nothing on. The emperor has nothing on."
Soon, everyone was murmuring,
"He has nothing on."
At last, the emperor himself began to think that they could be right. But then he thought,
"If I stop, it will spoil the procession, and that would never do."
So on he stepped, even more proudly than before. As for the courtiers, they went on carrying a train that was not there at all. What do we notice about this story? First, I have to say the false weavers are very smart. The tricksters understand how afraid people are of what others will think of them. Since nobody wants to be exposed as being bad at their job, everyone pretends to see the invisible fabric. It's a clever scam those crooks are running. They trick people into taking part in something called a mass delusion, where many people believe something that is obviously not true. This kind of thing does happen in real life. I've seen it more than once, and I've probably been a victim of this kind of trick myself. Second, something that's amazing to me is that none of the adults even consider the possibility that the false weavers are lying to them. They just accept what the crooks say is the truth. When a group of people all get locked into seeing something exactly the same way, and they stop asking questions, and they can't imagine any other possibilities, that is sometimes called groupthink. In the story, we see how silly and foolish groupthink can be. In real life, it is silly and foolish. Sometimes, it can even be dangerous. Finally, I notice that it's a child who speaks the truth about the emperor. She hasn't yet learned the strange, complicated reasons why grown-ups sometimes believe silly things. Children can see what's obvious right in front of them and will point it out. It's interesting to me that once the girl says out loud what's obvious, others start to say it too. The plain fact travels through the crowd, and soon even the emperor realizes it's true. To me, this story says that a lie can get into the minds of a whole country full of people. But when somebody finally speaks up to recognize what is right in front of our eyes, this will break the spell. This will drive out the lie and leave the naked truth exposed. That idea appeals to me. I hope in my heart of hearts that's how the world really works. Thank you so much for joining me for Read Aloud with Mr. Paul. Until next time, discover the wonder in a book. Pick one up Take a look.
If you enjoyed this Read Aloud with Mr. Paul, please like, subscribe, and share this video with your friends. Thanks again.